what I'm going to tell you about is kind of a long, long-lasting project that we have, you know, we have kept putting our time into. Whereby we, I mean, let me give acknowledgements here in the beginning. Where I mean our experimental collaborators, Olivier Marr, who is actually here now in Paris at the Vision Institute, and Dario and Michael, who were back in Princeton. And on the theory end, it's a collaboration between Elad Schneidman, Bill Bialik, who used to be my advisor, and Thierry Murat, who is one, well, who was here yesterday also. So this project has been going on now for a number of years, and what we are trying to do is we are trying to understand the thing that you see here in the background. That's not just a random texture. What you see here in the background, these little dots, those are actually spikes from real neurons in the retina, where time goes this way, and every little row is a response of one neuron, so this guy making two spikes here and so on. These neurons are all simultaneously recorded, so I'll show you how the device looks like, but basically this is what the retina is sending to the brain. Actually, it's much more because we cannot record all the neurons. Those are the rasters we would like to understand, whereby understand, you can, you know, there is many things you want to understand, right? So there is statistical structure amongst this, in this digital code, if you want. It's digital because these are action potentials, right? So neurons either are silent, like here, or they make these unitary stereotyped events called the spikes. So either you want to understand a statistical structure of this code, or perhaps you might want to understand how different stimuli that I'm not showing here on the slide, how they map into these responses, how they're encoded, or ultimately you might want to actually decode. So meaning that if you were able to observe this discrete digital code, you would be able to reconstruct what the eye was seeing at that moment. And there are a bunch of other questions you can address. So to motivate this a little bit more, so the question is, can we make sense of these joint activity patterns of many neurons, in particular when these neurons, as is in the case of retina, are responding to some rich stimulus, whereby rich stimulus I really mean naturalistic stimulus, something like this. This is in contrast to many experiments where you deliver some very purified stimulus, let's say random white noise, or even something that's spatially uniform and just light luminance is changing. So natural stimuli are very high dimensional. There is a lot of spatiotemporal structure in them. And we would like to understand how neurons encode such stimuli really at the level of single spikes, right? So not some firing rate averages or so on, but single unitary events. We would like to ask questions from the standpoint of coding, of information theory, of coding theory. For instance, I'll make these things more precise. I just now want to motivate. What do I mean by that? For instance, is this code independent? Namely, can I think of each neuron as a separate line that goes into the brain and reports, for instance, a neuron in the retina reports what's happening in this part of the sky, whether there is a bright spot or not, and then the neuron next door is independently saying whether there is a bright spot here, right? So that would kind of imply that if I understand how one neuron is working, I could simply, you know, basically I copy-paste that neuron across the visual field, and then I understand how all of them are working, right? So that would be the notion of a code being independent. The opposite of that notion is that the code in some sense is combinatorial. What that means is that, you know, when I look at a given neuron, let's say this one here, and it makes a spike, what this spike means needs to be interpreted in the context of, you know, the fact that this other neuron also spiked and this other neuron here did not spike at the same time and so on, right? So there is some sort of a combinatorial code that tells me what has been happening outside. So which of the two, or somewhere in between, which of the two extremes, or anything in between this real code, where do they lie, right? And then the last question is, and this is now relating to what Thierry tried to motivate as a top-down and bottom-up approaches, is, so, you know, this will be an approach where we start with the data, as I will say soon, and we'd like to go from the data, but ultimately connect to some theoretical work, some very beautiful work that has been done on neural coding, neural networks, and so on, but that has been done in the context of simplified toy models. So you might have heard, maybe not, of things like Hopfield's model of associative memory, which is very closely related to spin glasses and so on, which is a fantastic simple proposal for how memory could work, right? So how the brain could recall stored patterns of activity as dynamical attractors in some network. So it's a beautiful model. It makes, you know, you can analyze it analytically in great detail. But the question is, how would you ever test whether this, you know, model really happens in a part of the brain? So that, of course, you may need to make contact with the data. But the whole point of these beautiful models are they're extremely collective, right? So it's all about, you know, neurons doing something together. So connecting that directly to the data is actually hard. In this case, we'll take the other approach. We'll start from the data. As maybe I can motivate here. We'll start with the data. We will create, and the data will be rasters like this. We'll create what we call inverse statistical physics models for these activity patterns. We, of course, need to check that these models are good descriptions of the data, but then we can really study the behavior of these models in detail, right? And maybe see if we can, from them, find signs of such nice, complex processing that was then before proposed, or, you know, even long time ago proposed in the context of simple toy models. So let me now motivate the experimental system. I assume most of you don't know, are not from the neurobiology side. But for those of you who are, maybe this will be known already. So the system we'll look at is the retina. So it's the piece of tissue in your eye that takes light signals, spatiotemporal patterns of light, and transduces them into discrete electrical spikes that are sent to the brain. So here is a schematic diagram. It's really a beautiful piece of stereotype tissue. It extends, you know, in this way. So these are photoreceptors, cells that, you know, are hit by photons, and the photons cause the change in the pigment, and there is a whole cascade of chemical reactions happening there. And this, the signals, the electrical signals at the output of the cell filter through these, what is essentially a three-layer network. So bipolar cells are these red things here, and the retinal ganglion cells are at the bottom. They're of different types. There is also cells that enforce horizontal connections, and I'm not detailing any of this. But basically, signals travel, light signals induce things here, and the electrical signals then will travel from this ganglion cell layer through their axons to the brain. So everything the brain knows about the visual world is stored or is sent via these fibers of the last layer of these cells, and these are already spiking cells. So they make the spikes that I showed from before. Because this is a planar tissue, you can dissect it from the eye, right? So, and the animals that were used for these experiments are either salamanders. I'll show salamander data here. You can do it. It's often done on mice and rats and guinea pigs and so on. So you can take the retina out of the eye, it's this little piece of planar tissue, and you can record from many of these cells. I'll show you the apparatus on the next slide. And then you have your black box coding device that you can essentially perfectly control and record from. You can perfectly control it because the input to this is light, and so you can just project down on the retina any sort of stimulation you want. You can do synthetic stimuli or naturalistic stimuli. You can repeat exactly the same stimulus over and over, which, if you think about it, is a very nice feature in biological systems, right? That you can make, let's say, 100 or even 1,000 repeats of the same little stimulus clip. And then at the output, you record this activity patterns. And one of the central questions of neuroscience is then, what is the mapping between the stimuli impinging here and the outputs of these cells? And this is really a paradigm for population coding. That means, you know, how do all these guys together encode the stimulus, especially when that's a rich and naturalistic stimulus. Now, if you open a textbook on neurobiology of seeing, what you will see is a very cartoonish schematization of how the retina works, which I'll now present. And, you know, the title of the slide I gave to this is somewhat provocatively, wait, isn't retina just a camera? In the following sense, you could think of a retina as a very, you know, as a biological analogon of a CCD device, all right? So working in the following way, you have these retinal ganglion cells, these cells that send the signals to the brain. And what we know from various experiments, classical experiments that I won't go into the detail, is that to a decent approximation, you could think of every one of these cells as doing a particular relatively simple transformation on the light inputs that look like this. Take a little patch of the sky and light input there, and filter it with a linear filter that looks a little bit like that. So that's a 2D linear filter that has a positive peak in the center and a negative surround, right? So it's kind of a filter that in cross section, let's say, looks like that, right? Where this is spatial position, and it's 2D, right? So there is a Y here, right? So basically, if you filter a natural scene or any other scene with such a filter, this filter will give you a strong signal when you have a localized peak of light, right? If you put in a constant light background, you will simply subtract the center from the surround and the output of this will be zero. So this is kind of, if you want, a detector for localized spots of light. Okay, so each cell performs somehow a filtering like this. We even know anatomically how this filtering might be implemented by that little network of photoreceptors and bipolar cells. Not only that, there is actually a theory called efficient coding that says if you wanted to take natural scenes, scenes with the statistics that you can measure in nature, so spatial temporal correlations of light that I can measure, if you wanted to encode those signals well, this is actually a smart filtering to apply on the scenes. Why is that? It's because natural scenes have very long-range correlations of light, and it would be wasteful to encode, like if you have a bright spot like this, it would be wasteful to have neurons saying bright, 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 because there is a large degree of correlation. You can simply report the changes. You don't need to say bright, bright, bright and make many spikes all the time. You simply say, oh, here it changes from bright to dark. So there is a contrast change here and here, but you don't need to say explicitly for every pixel what has happened. And this will be achieved by that filter. This can formally be derived in the context of efficient coding. So even theory says that's a smart idea. And based on this, you can build a simple mathematical model that can predict the spiking of a single cell quite well. Take a natural scene, filter it by such a filter. The output of such a filter goes into a nonlinear function that you can map from the data. So meaning, if this filter output is highly positive, here is the spiking rate, here is the filter output. So if it's highly positive, make a lot of spikes. And of course, you cannot, if it's negative, you cannot make negative spikes, right? So the neuron is just silent. So it's a kind of a thresholding nonlinearity. And based on that, you could simply try to predict what this neuron is doing. So this is, you put in the movie and you predict the firing rate of this neuron and you can compare this to data. So with one additional assumption that the retina is kind of a tiling, is a mosaic. So you have many of these cells and they are, approximately identical. You can just put them one next to the other, right? So now you know how one neuron works. You put them one next to the other and now you know how the whole patch of the retina works. You could simply claim, all right, that's a computational model of the retina. It's not that different from a CCD camera. It does a little bit of pre-processing with this filtering and so on, but that's all it does, okay? Now, we should, therefore, know everything about how the retina represents stimulus information. And in addition, this whole thing makes a prediction because these filters are decorrelating. They're only reporting the changes. This would predict, and again, this you can make a bit more formal. It could predict that if you look at the outputs of lots of cells from the retina, they will be essentially statistically independent or decorrelated. Because they look at different points in the sky, each one is filtering out the correlations in the signal, both in time and the space. I haven't shown the temporal part. And therefore, the correlation at the output of the retina should be very small. So what I would like to argue today is to say that this picture, although there is, of course, truth to that, this has been documented and so on, but when you look at lots of cells, this picture is simply incorrect. All right, the neural spike trends are not decorrelated. And in particular, it's also true that if you were to test these kinds of models, not on the synthetic stimuli that people use in the lab, so simple white noise stimuli or drifting bars or so on, but if you actually test it on true natural images, these models actually do not work, even in terms of predicting the properties of single neurons. All right, so how do we study this in the lab, or how do our experimental colleagues do that? So as I said, you can take the retina out of the animal and you can place it down on a microelectrode array. It's shown here. That's a little chip which has electrodes. These are these dots that are spaced by about 30 microns. So there is 252 of them in this particular array. So you place the retina down and press it on this array. You keep it perfused with the solution that it likes and at the right temperature, and you can therefore keep it alive, depending on the animal, salamander, 6 hours, rat, maybe 2-3 hours of stable recording time. And meanwhile, you can then deliver, you know, stimulation that you want and record from these ganglion cells. Now, the really, really unique feature of this preparation of our colleagues is that these electrodes are very, very dense. What that means is that, you know, the retina is much bigger than the array. The retina is, you know, a large piece of tissue. But in this little piece that sits above the electrodes, you can essentially record from every, well, let's say 90% or more of these output neurons that sit on top of the array. All right? And since we do know that in the retina there is this retinotopic organization, so cells that are close within the retina, they encode for stimuli that are connected in a piece of the sky, you have a rather unique situation in neuroscience. You're able to record from essentially all the neurons in a little patch of the retina, and those neurons are essentially all the neurons that tell the brain what is happening here. So you have an essentially complete representation of a piece of the stimulus world. All right. And this is in contrast to other neuroscience preparations where you might, you know, stick an electrode in the cortex, you measure from one or tens or even hundreds of neurons if you have more electrodes, but that constitutes a tiny, tiny, tiny fraction of all the neurons there. So there is always all this other stuff that you cannot experimentally listen to. There is not many setups where you can get this very high coverage, so this is one of them. So, to show you how this works, or how this looks like a little bit more concretely, what is being shown here, and this, there will be a little movie that hopefully runs. So this will be the naturalistic movie that was shown to the particular salamander retina. It will be a fish swimming around in the fish tank. But before I show the movie, that is the so-called receptive field center of one of the cells. So now the receptive field is simply this feature of neurons that I described, which is if I look at the single neuron, its activity can be modulated if stimuli change in a spatially compact location. So for this particular neuron, stimuli that change around here can affect its behavior, but stimuli that are here, they do not. All right? So for one neuron, this is where it looks like. And remember, we record from hundreds of neurons because we have 252 electrodes. So if I now superpose all these neurons that we recorded from on this picture, these are their receptive fields. So this is now, again, just illustrating what I said before, that this little piece of the retina is now encoding for stimuli that happen in this localized region of my image or of the sky. And the first thing you see here already is that these receptive fields are densely overlapping. So for every point in space here, there won't be one neuron reporting about it. There will be, you know, roughly order 10 neurons or even more, tens of neurons reporting for, you know, every particular point in space. And this overcomplete representation is a generic feature of the retina. So the fact that I don't have any receptive field here is simply I don't have a big enough electrode array. Otherwise, I would see this dense tiling all over the picture. Right? So to see how this looks dynamically now, let's run this movie clip. You will see the stimulus, and then every time a particular neuron that's recorded fires, this its ellipse will blink. Right? Just to see how this looks like. Hopefully, this runs. So they look here. Remember, nothing is changing here, so you have some spontaneous activity, and now a fish will come this way. All right, so fish comes, right? It crosses the receptive fields of these neurons, and since that's a change in local change in contrast, you saw this burst of activity of neurons going, right, following the fish, right? So, and now you can, you know, either make display such a very long movie of this sort, or you can just take this little clip and repeat it many times, depends on what kind of experiment, what question they want to answer. But basically, that's the design. You know, you display a particular stimulus and then, right, like here, so a particular stimulus, in this case naturalistic, the output of the experiment is now a raster, which time going here and you know, this is already spike sorted. It's a big data processing problem I'm not going into, but essentially I have identified neurons whose responses are schematized in this way. There is lots of questions, so I'll go. Go ahead. That's a good question. So there is multiple reasons for that. The first is that these retinal ganglion, the retinal ganglion cells, the cells we record from, that I showed you the ellipses for, they are actually of different types, where by type you can either mean functional types, meaning if I show very specific stimuli, there would be different neurons that respond to specific classes of stimuli. But that, it actually turns out, is also a genetic statement. So there are cells, they're all of retinal ganglion cell, you know, super type, but within those, there is a classification both by anatomy and both by the types of proteins that these cells express. So there is, so that's one reason. So you, in that respect, you have retinal ganglion cells that have bigger or smaller receptive fields. But also within, there is also variability within a type. So even if you know, you know, precisely, you know, that, you know, there is, you only look at, I don't know, subtype A, of course they don't have exactly equal receptive fields, but they're roughly, they're much more similar than across types, and B, they tile the visual space. So there is something very nice about the organization of the retina that I'm not talking about here, which is that, you know, if I look at the receptive fields of separate types, if I could, you know, color code those by type, those ellipses, you'd basically see that, you know, one type does something like that, right? And then there would be type A, and then there would be type B, let's say, with smaller receptive fields doing this. So actually each type is separately constructing a tiling mosaic. And that was also one of the early, I mean, you can even use that to define cells of the same type, you know, which are the cells that form a nice mosaic of approximately the same receptive field size.
Shouldn't it, correct me if I'm wrong, should the area of the receptive field also depend on the magnification of the optical system you're using to project the image onto the cell?
You can measure, let's say, it in several different ways, right? I mean, you can either do it just simply as microns on the retina, or you can just express it in some sort of units of visual angle, then effectively, right? So these ones were simply microns on the retina.
Just another small question.
Yeah.
Does it matter that you lose the curvature of the retina by pressing it flat on the
chip? Experimentally, I think it does in that it makes the life of the experimentalists a bit more hard, because by doing the press, so you have to press a bit to get a good contact. But because the thing is slightly curving, you also can harm the retina. I mean, you have to do it just right, right? But yes, it can. I mean, it does affect their lives. It doesn't affect my life, but yes.
How do you exactly describe the visual area?
All right. So that's a great question. How do you get these receptive fields? How does one know? So there is a very nice body of theory in electrical engineering, the so-called system identification problem or approaches, where, you know, you are given an unknown black box and you'd like to figure out what kind of processing it is doing. And, you know, for linear systems, this has been you have a black box, and here are its responses R, and here are the stimulus that go in S. And you know, suppose that this system is, you know, some linear system L, and you want to figure out what this L is, right? So the usual approach is, or one of the possible approaches is, simply feed into the system a synthetic signal with some with simple statistical properties, let's say Gaussian white noise, and then there is a so-called reverse correlation. So if you correlate the input signal with the output responses, you can back out the linear filter, right? In this actual concrete case, you do something like this. You fit in binary noise, which is simply you display to the retina frames that look like this. It's a checkerboard, and then on every frame you independently draw whether each check is black or white. So it's kind of this fastly flickering checkerboard. You feed this into the retina, you do this reverse correlation, and actually there is a very nice theorem that says that even if the system is not linear, if it's of the following form, if it's of the form response equals some nonlinear function, pointwise nonlinear function of the linear kernel convolved with the stimulus, if you do this reverse correlation, you still can get out the unbiased estimate of the, if this input that goes in is a Gaussian type thing, or spherical or symmetric, you can get out the correct linear kernel. And that's what is shown there. You feed in this checkerboard, you do this reverse correlation, and then what you find is for each cell, you find its spatial-temporal linear filter, which looks like, those Mexican hat things I was sketching before. So that's the center, that's the ellipse I was drawing, right? So that's one approach on how it.
So you run tests.
Yeah, exactly. Sorry. Yeah. So before every experiment, canonically you run a bunch of synthetic stimuli that then help you figure out, these things like what's the receptive field, where the receptive fields are, and so on. You can do also more fancy maximum likelihood time inference approaches where you can display directly a rich stimulus, like a natural stimulus, and then do likelihood maximization and still get out. But it's more computation is more demanding. You can get out receptive fields even from natural stimuli, but then you have to do bigger scale inference. Yes?
Here the movie is in black and white, and I don't know if the salamander, how the salamander eye is constructed, but do retina cells responding to color act the same as the ones responding to light, or is it
So salamander also does see color, actually. It's not, as far as I know, it's not a trichromat, I think. But basically what most of this, I mean, historically, these experiments have really split into people who study specifically color, and then people who study simply spatial-temporal correlations of light using grayscale images. These are all images projected at the light intensity that is, daylight intensity. So none of these experiments that I'm showing is so they all work on cones, if you know, the type of photoreceptor is a cone. So none of these experiments are the, night vision rod experiments, which are by nature only black and white. I mean, they're only grayscale in nature, right? So this will still be daylight vision cells that respond to color. You only decide to stimulate them only using black and white or grayscale stimuli just to make your life simpler. I mean, but there are separate people who study the color responses. All right. So we have this we have these rasters, and we to start our description, we'll describe them by chunking time into very little time bins, and I can discuss where the size of the time bin comes from. So these time bins are very small, and then within the time bin I can describe the instantaneous state of my recorded population as these binary code words, meaning neuron 1 did not fire in this time bin and neuron 2 did fire, etc., right? So the time bins are small enough that the probability that every neuron, a given neuron, would actually make more than one spike in that time bin is very small. It does happen sometimes, but the fraction of a percent. So this is, if you will, a binary approximation to the responses of my neurons, but it's a pretty good approximation for the salamander on this 20 millisecond timescale. So I denote the state of each neuron by this sigma I, and then W is this binary word emitted at a particular time. So immediately I can ask now several questions in this framework. So the first question, and this is what we will mostly be concerned with today, is the question about vocabulary. So if I simply run a long experiment and I record the binary words coming from the retina, I can try to ask how probable is each one of these words, right? Which patterns don't happen ever, or I don't observe ever, and which patterns happen very often. Now, let me say two more things and I'll give you an analogy. I could also, and we have done this in separate works that I won't discuss today, we could also construct not just the vocabulary, so what are the possible combinations of words that the retina emits, but the so-called code book, which is, what is the probability that the retina says something if a particular stimulus was displayed, right? Not over the duration of the whole experiment as here, but for a particular stimulus, what's the probability? So that's why it's a code book, right? It maps the stimuli to responses. And you can, if you repeat the same stimulus over and over and over, right, so here are rasters to response to repeats of the same thing, I can even ask what's the probability at the particular time in the repeat that the retina is emitting a certain word. So that would also be a valid question, and it's something that people study. Or alternatively, you can study the so-called dictionary, which is given that the retina has generated the response, a particular response, what's the probability over stimuli that was the stimulus that gave rise to this response. So that's kind of a decoding view, right? From given the response, you try to back out what was the stimulus. Now, let me say that studying this vocabulary is a little bit like studying, you'd ask, why do you want to do that? Don't we want to do this or this? Like, don't we want to decode or encode? Why do we just study the distribution over patterns? It's a little bit like studying the unknown language by taking a book and then studying the statistical properties of words and letters in that unknown language. You don't actually know what the words mean, but you can still learn a lot about the structure of this unknown stuff by looking at, correlations and so on, right? It absolves you of one thing that in otherwise you have to assume, which is here in these approaches, and that's a more common approach to neuroscience, you have to somehow assume how stimulus maps into the code words, because stimulus is this awfully high dimensional object, right? It's a movie clip. So, it's number of pixels times the number of pixels times time frames back into the past. So you have to make drastic simplifying assumptions if you want to build models for this. Which usually are bad. So we'll study this restrictive thing, but you can study the other ones too. And still there is a major problem, which is that if you record from n neurons, and even in this binary 0-1 approximation, the state space of this probability distribution is humongous, right? So it's 2 to the n, where n is the number of neurons that you record. And it's clear that if you record for many neurons, direct sampling won't get you anywhere, right? By just counting how many times you see each pattern. So what we use is we use the maximum entropy models, which I would like to explain, and Thierry was alluding to. So we'll use maximum entropy models to try. To try to build approximations to the distribution over all possible states. So my state are these activity patterns of the neurons, right? So each neuron I, where I goes from 1 to n, can be either silent or firing, and I want a model for a distribution over these states, right? So this is now a vector of n binary things. So how do I do that in the maximum entropy construction? Let me first go through this abstract series of steps, and then we can work it out. So the first thing that I would do is I would choose a certain number, L, of functions of the system. So the system state is this sigma 1 to sigma n, these guys, and I'll just choose some functions, right, that I can compute from this instantaneous state. But I would choose this function such that I can take the empirical average over the value of this function through my data set, over my data set, such that these empirical averages are well constrained. So I can get the bootstrap error bars on these things, and they can be estimated well from my finite amount of data. Remember, this is all solving the problem that I have a finite amount of data from which I want to build a large dimensional distribution, right? Data limitation is somehow crucial. So once I select these functions that I can empirically estimate their averages off from the data, I ask, so what is the distribution P that first exactly matches each of these expectation values? So if I want to construct a distribution, okay, so let me write this down. So I want a distribution P such that when I take the expectation value of each of these f's, so at the end, the expectation value is, I take the sum over all states of p sigma f, f mu sigma, so that's the expectation value of f mu over my model p. So I want this thing to exactly match, so this is a requirement, the expectation value of this same function f mu, but now taken over my data. So that's an empirical average. If you want, I can I can write it out as 1 over t, where t is the number of data samples in the experiment. Data samples. 1 over t, right, the sum of over all these data samples, f mu sigma, I should index this thing, right, sigma t. So that's sample number t, right? So that's my first requirement. My distribution should exactly reproduce these constraints in the data. But there is, of course, many such distributions, right? So among the distribution that satisfy this constraint, I'll pick the one that also maximizes the entropy. So I want a distribution that, formally, so let's see. So I want maximum over p of the entropy s of p of sigma, where that's a classical, if you want, Shannon entropy, right? S of p is equal to minus the sum over all states, p of sigma log p of sigma, right? So if you will, I can now combine this maximization of entropy, this s, with the constraints here that I want to match into a sort of Lagrange multiplier type problem, right? So I form a Lagrangian of p, right? So the first is I want to maximize the entropy, so the sum over p sigma log p sigma. But then I also have to match all of these constraints. So how do I do that? Well, I put in another, for each constraint, let the constraints be this mu, go from 1 to L. I put in a Lagrange multiplier, lambda mu, and then I need to insert the constraint that I have right there, which is that f mu over data minus f mu over p is equal to 0, right? And then there is one trivial constraint that I have that's kind of natural, which is that the distribution itself needs to be normalized, right? So that's an additional, let's call it trivial constraint. Let me just write it. So minus Lagrange multiplier that corresponds to that constraint times, right, the sum over all mu p mu minus 1, if you want, right? So that enforces normalization, right? And now this somehow looks weird, but it's actually super simple. So if you now take the derivative of this Lagrangian with respect to p of sigma and set it to 0, what do you have to do? Well, it's actually kind of trivial. That, for these purposes, is just a number, right? That's a number that's evaluated over the data, so it doesn't do anything. This thing here is the expectation of my f over p, which is this, and it's simply linear in p. So when you take a derivative, you only get an f, right? There is nothing more there. This is also just linear. I mean, it's just a sum, right, over p. And so the only term that's actually, a bit non-trivial is that when you take a derivative of this thing with respect to p, so one you get log p once, and the other time you actually get a 1, right? So you can just do that. I mean, I invite you to do it. It's two lines. And if you do it, you will see that all maximum entropy distributions can be written in the form that's written there above. So it's 1 over normalization constant exponent of the sum over all constraints, mu, 1 to L. The Lagrange multiplier, maybe it's scaled a bit, so this lambda doesn't really matter. So there's some constant times this function of the state here. All right, so that's the functional for. So if you ask for a maxent model that's consistent with some constraints, it will have this particular form, right? Here are your constraints, and what's the unknown part is this g mu. So these Lagrange multipliers here. So these things are now the thing that you need to find. All right. So remember, this is a form, but these things, there is particular values that this g mu need to have, that you need to find, such that they will match these constraints. So the building the model then reduces to having a procedure for fitting, if you want, this g mu, right? So you can do that in several ways. Let me see how I'm doing on time, if I try to illustrate this or not. You can do that in several ways. Perhaps to connect with what Thierry was saying, you can, now that you have a functional form, you can view it as a maximum likelihood fitting problem, right? You want the maximum likelihood values for this G mu here. So you could let's take a look how that would work, so that I give you a little bit of a technical insight on how you construct such models, and connect a little bit to this inference stuff that Thierry was discussing. So my model of the distribution is right there, and now I would like to find the values of G by maximizing the likelihood over some data, all right? And data, again, remember, data are my patterns, sigma t, right? So, and I have t data samples, right? So I can write down the likelihood, and the likelihood will be the product, right? So I have, for you remember Thierry's talk, so for each particular sample, there is a probability of observing that sample, given that I have some parameters g that I would like. And since I have t independent data points, I take a product. So that's now the likelihood of observing this particular samples given these parameters. And what's the usual way to write this down is to take an average log of this quantity, the so-called, so this is the likelihood. So if you do the average log likelihood, which is the common thing to do in inference, let's call it big L, is equal to its average over all time points. And now I take the log of that. So it's the log of the product is the sum of the logs. So here I have the sum now over all data points of log p sigma t given the parameters. Right? So, and now my task is to maximize the likelihood with respect to these unknown parameters right there. So let me just take that functional form and insert it into this formula. So I'll have 1 over t, the sum, right? And now I have the log of this, which has an exponential form, right? So I can write it out as minus the log of z, the partition function, plus whatever is in the exponential, right? Plus the sum over mu, so all constraints, g mu, f mu of sigma, right? And so when I maximize the likelihood with respect to the parameters, I have to do dl dg mu, right? There is many parameters. So let's say I take the derivative with respect to nu, and something nice happens, right? So I get two terms. First of all, notice that this term is independent of the sample, right? So this is this sum doesn't affect it. You could just, you know, you can just pull it out. So there is a d log z over d g nu. And then here, when I take the derivative with respect to g nu, I just get the f nu back, right? So and there is a minus, sorry, there is a minus. And then I get a plus 1 over t, the sum over all samples to t. And here I only have the f nu of sigma t, right? So if from your statistical physics, you will recognize that if you take the derivative of the partition function with respect to the nth coupling, you just get the nth observable back. So that is f nu. In my average of f nu in my distribution p, right? And that is the empirical average of f nu over my data, right? So that's the empirical average of f nu over the data. So what does this say? This says that if I want to maximize the likelihood, I can simply, you know, by climbing the gradient, I can simply construct a learning rule. So how to fit these parameters by saying g. So let's do it iteratively by climbing the gradient slowly. G nu at iteration, how should I denote this? Tau plus 1 is the coupling at iteration tau, plus going a little bit up the gradient by some learning rate alpha. And the gradient is right here. And it simply amounts to the difference of the nu observable in the data minus the current value of the news observable in the model. So simply saying, when my model, when the observable in my data is, let's say, too big, so I simply need to tweak up the coupling a little bit more, right? And then I iterate, and when I exactly match the observables in my model and in the data, this is zero, and I found my maximum likelihood value of the coupling. So that just, now technically, it turns out that this is more complicated, but there is theory that says that given observables that you measure in the data, there is, so it's a convex problem, there is only one set of couplings that reproduces exactly the observables, all right? So it's, in that respect, it's nice because gradient climbing will always get you to the correct solution. You might say why it is hard. It's hard because what you need to do during the learning, technically, is you need to get this done. That's the expectation value of your observable under the distribution you're trying to learn. And you know that when the distribution gets to be very large, then you oftentimes have no resort but to estimate these things via Monte Carlo sampling. All right? And not only that, you have to do this within the learning procedure. So for every of these steps, you need to, you know, Monte Carlo sample, update your parameters, Monte Carlo sample, update your parameters, which can take a long time. There is smarter ways to do it, but in fact, for many models, this is just, you know, that's the only procedure that you have available. All right, so now let's make this a little bit more concrete. You know, that's a framework, but the framework doesn't tell you anything about what do you choose for these observables. I mean, whatever you choose, that's what you do, but what do you choose? And so the baseline choices that you can think about is, so first, let's get the first order marginals of my model matched to the data. So what I can do is I can select for these functions f simply the state of every single variable, right? And by doing that, if you think about what kind of distribution this will get me, is it will get me a distribution. So let's go back here. Right now, this f mu are just simply, you know, sigmas, right? So the distribution will look in this particular case as 1 over z times the exponent, the sum over all neurons. Let me now write, because I guess you're more used to it, instead of g mu, some abstract coupling, let me write hi sigma I. I guess that will be more recognizable as an Ising model with just a field, but no Jij coupling, right? So this you can view as a maximum entropy model that where HIs can be tuned such that the rate of firing for every neuron, the average rate of activation for every neuron is exactly matched to the data, but is otherwise as random as possible, right? So this model matches all first point marginals, but nothing else, and it's independent, so it's trivial, right? This factorizes. So, you know, partition function is, again, is a one-line thing. So that's a simple thing. We'll see how well it does on the data. However, as soon as you go to the next step, you already hit a non-trivial model, right? So now I want to have a model that reproduces exactly the firing rate of every single neuron and of every pair, the pairwise correlation between every pair. So now this means that in my model, there is a new term that gets added here that looks like ij. Let's write it in the conventional notation, jij, sigma I, sigma j. And now I need to find jij's as well as hi's such that this distribution exactly reproduces the mean firing rate of every neuron and the covariance between every pair. And notice there is no symmetry of any kind here, all right? So there is no structure to these jij's. They need to be learned to match exactly the data. There is no, you know, nearest neighbor concept or anything like that imposed on the model. Right? It could come out, but you know, there is nothing per se like that. But of course, you are not limited to these moments. I mean, you can do many other things. You can, for instance, do something which I'm going to explain in this talk too, where in you know, you can constrain some global feature of the activity. So, for instance, this one, which is a little bit of a cumbersome way to write the following: look at all the neurons in every time bin. Simply sum up how many are active. You know, it's just a sum of how many have made a spike, and call that k, all right? So now constrain the distribution of this k across the whole experiment. So how many times are zero neurons active? How many times is only one, whichever one, active? How many times are two active, and so on, right? And so then you can build maximum entropy models by mixing and matching these constraints however you want. I won't go into the detail, but I would like to just mention that this is quite powerful in that you can constrain really all sorts of correlations here. So you could make models for dynamics as well. So here we are all focusing on instantaneous state of the retina. I could make models that constrain the activity of neuron I at time bin t and the activity of neuron j at the next time bin, for instance, to get a dynamical model, right? This would constrain temporal correlations from time bin to time bin. Or you could make even models, and this has been done already and published by other people, or you could even do models where you constrain the activity of, let's say, a neuron I conditioned on some external variable. Let's say the stimulus. So then you can construct stimulus-dependent models, right? But we are not, so it's possible, but we are not going to talk about these things. All right, so that's a general framework. I wanted to write out a few things, not to go too quickly through this. But let's first clarify some questions that keep coming up when one introduces this framework. So what are really Maxent models and what they are not? So the Maxent models are descriptions of stationary probability distributions. All right? So here, stationary, take a stimulus, repeat it many times. There is stationary statistics, you can check that. That's an experimental fact. So let's say if mean firing rates of the neurons are stable, covariances are stable if you take first half, second half of the experiment, and so on, right? And for that distribution of states, you can build a model. These models, despite the very close mathematical similarity to the Boltzmann distribution, mathematical they are of the Boltzmann form, they are not assuming that anything is in thermal equilibrium. In particular, there is no notion of temperature that you see here, all right? So having said differently, Boltzmann distribution of classical thermodynamics is a maximum entropy model, but there is other assumptions that go into that, right? So there is detailed balance, it's equilibrium, et cetera, et cetera. And in that case, the Boltzmann distribution is a maximum entropy distribution, which you can think of as a single constraint, which is a constraint on average energy, and the Lagrange multiplier is 1 over kBT, all right? So that's the link to classical statistical physics. But in general, maximum entropy models do not assume thermal equilibrium, right? And retina in particular is a driven system. It's not an equilibrium system. Now, these couplings that you might infer, this JIJ, right? This JIJ give you a coupling between two neurons, right? So positive. So these couplings are what we call functional, which means that, you know, a positive JIJ will mean that neurons I and J like to spike together. A negative JIJ will mean they don't like to spike together. That is true, but what they are not, and some in neuroscience that's a big discussion, is they are not physiological couplings. The fact that you have a positive number here does not mean that these two neurons are actually connected by wire. They could be connected by wire, but there is also many other reasons why functionally they would like to spike together. They have overlapping receptive field, they have a common source of noise. I mean, there is many molecular or mechanistic ways in which two neurons can get coupled. And it depends on the input, right? This the way we do it. And lastly, these models for stationary things, they don't assume any microscopic dynamics, right? So, you know, usually you bring things with you from thermodynamics, right, where you might say, oh, it's like Glauber dynamics for spins or something like that. There is many dynamical schemes that will yield the same stationary distribution we're trying to describe here, and this stationary distribution is not saying things about the dynamics. All right. Despite this, you know, one can learn a lot about the code by studying these distributions. So let me now have a historical slide. How has this been applied to data? All right. So this goes back to the to neural data. So this goes back to the paper by Elad Schneidman and all. This was also in the group of Michael Berry. They looked at small groups of 10 neurons, and they looked at the correlation coefficient in the spike trains between pairs of neurons. And the observation is as follows: if you histogram the correlation coefficients, they are all small. These are normalized to be on the scale of between -1 and 1. And so you see most of them are close to zero. These are actually statistically significant because you have enough data, but they're all small. And so the question that arose from this is, well, perhaps these correlations can be neglected. The population is almost independent. And that fitted very well with the theoretical picture. In the beginning, the retina should be independent, right? So, you know, so kind of is a nice, you know, it goes hand in hand together. But then the question was, maybe we should check, right? Whether this independence is a good approximation or not. So how do you check? Well, you can do it by taking the real data and constructing either this model, which does not reproduce these very small correlations. It assumes neurons are independent. Or you include that term, in which case you have an Ising-like model, which reproduces exactly these correlations, despite the fact that they are small. Now you have two distributions, and you can compare both to data. Right? So you fit this Ising-like distribution with pairwise correlations. And this was, let's say, the punchline result of that paper. So what you do here is you take groups of 10 neurons, and you find every pattern, possible combinatorial pattern of their activity. So this particular one is neuron 1 fires and neuron 9 fires. Everyone else is silent. You actually have enough data that for every such of 1024, right, 2 to the 10 patterns, for every one such pattern, you can estimate its empirical probability well enough, because the experiment is so long that you have enough data to do that. So here is its empirical true probability. And now on this axis, you plot either the model where you neglect these small correlation coefficients, which is the blue, or the pairwise model where you take them into account, which is the red. And this is the equality line. And note that that's a log scale plot. So this says that despite the fact that correlation coefficients between pairs are very small, if you neglect them, you get the blue model, which essentially is orders of magnitude wrong for most of the patterns. However, if you take them into account, you can essentially, and this is small scale, small data scatter, you can get consistency between the data and the model. So in this case, it's small enough network so you can do all this fitting of models exactly and so on. And the upshot of that work was that pairwise correlations between every pair of neurons are weak, but their collective effect already at the size of the group of 10 are actually quite large. Right? So what we wanted to do afterwards, motivated by this, is now the experiments become bigger. So can we scale this up to hundreds of neurons that we have in our recording? So we do essentially the same preparation, natural movie, discretize the spike trains. We now, these reconstructions, model fittings now become much harder because of the need to do this Monte Carlo sampling, and they take a long time and so on. So there is lots of technical problems, but it's possible to do this. And we'll consider two classes of models. Again, the pairwise model, exactly as you see here, and exactly as I was shown before, and the model that is a refinement of that that I will show you. So you take 100 neurons, you measure the correlation coefficient matrix between 100 by 100 neurons, you measure the mean firing rates here in the physicist Ising notation between minus 1 and 1, and from this you now compute this JIJ matrix, you fit the JIJs here and the magnetic fields here to exactly reproduce in the model this whole thing and this whole thing. What you notice immediately is that the coupling matrix of JIJ is frustrated, is rather dense and it's frustrated, which already hints that something interesting could happen. And what you can check is that, going back to what Thierry said, that you have not overfit and you have really fitted everything to within experimental bars and so on. So there is technical details there. Now, the first thing we notice is that when you go to 100 neurons, these models are actually not reproducing the data very well. And to see that, we looked at this particular statistic, which is the distribution of the total activity, right? So again, as said, in every timing, you simply sum how many neurons are active, and you look whether your model gets this right. So here I will show you for three different network sizes, 10 neurons, 40 neurons, 100, taken out of this recording. So for 10 neurons, so here is the probability of K neurons simultaneously active, 0, 5 doing something, spiking at the same time. Data is the red and model, pairwise model is the black, so the match is still pretty good. But if you go to large networks of neurons like you see here, you see that the data and the model have now started to really deviate in the tail. But not only that, if you focus, since this is a log scale, right? So you can focus right here at p equals 0. What's the probability that no one spikes? All right? That's the best sampled pattern empirically. And the model doesn't get it right by effectively a factor of 2 or 3 already. So the pairwise model is not sufficient when you go to these large networks. However, what I will try to claim is that when you include now this synchrony curve, this P of K, as another constraint to actually make an Ising model, to make a maximum model that constrains the mean firing rate, the pairwise correlations, but also the probability of K neurons spiking together, that you actually get a model that can reproduce many of the things in the data, as I will show. All right? There is actually a physiological reason why this is a good, why this might be a good idea. So it's known that you have global regulation of activity in the retina, so and also in cortex and so on, either by global inhibition or something like this. So the, you know, there is a motivation for why that actually might be operative. A new constraint, so these are magnetic fields, these are couplings, and now you have this, basically it's like a potential that reproduces, you know, it's another term here, right, corresponding to this new Lagrange multiplier that reproduces the P of K exactly in the data. So we can construct such models, and I'm happy to discuss the details if somebody asks how to do it. But I would like to focus on this. So now you have a model, all right? What kind of, what questions can you ask of it? And so there is essentially four groups of things that you can do. First of all, you can actually compute bounds on certain interesting quantities that are theoretically tight. And I will show you how you compute the bound on information transmission by this population, or the bound on entropy. You can ask the model to do directly verifiable predictions. So, you know, the model is maximum entropy, which is as random as possible, except for the things that it explicitly constrains. So every new statistic that it reproduces is by the nature of it a prediction, right? Because it was not put into the model in any sense. Third, it can constructively disprove existing claims. For instance, the one I will show is that this neural code is not nearly independent, is not even close to being independent, and actually that correlations between the neurons are strong enough to enable a sort of error correction. And then it gives rise to two interesting hypotheses about the neural code. One is this tuning to criticality, and the other one that the information could be encoded by metastable states or attractor-like states. So I'd like to now go through several of these in the remaining time that we have. So let me start with point number one, so which is what we can do is we can, so now we have a probabilistic model that looks like much like your statistical physics. It's only, you know, what's weird about it is that it has this global P of V of K potential, but basically you have this Boltzmann thing and you can try to compute its entropy, right? Now, the nice thing if you compute its entropy is that by construction, this entropy has to be an upper bound on the true entropy of the patterns. Why? Because you build a maximum entropy model, right? So the better model you do in this framework, the entropy of those better models can only go down, right? It's a maximum entropy by construction. So you're upper bounding the entropy, and by upper bounding the entropy, you're also upper bounding the information transmission, because information is a difference between this entropy and some other term, right? That's also, that's positive and so on and so on, right? So the question is, you know, can we, so what do we learn about the entropy of this activity? This is now very funny. For those of you who have actually been busy computing in statistical physics the entropy, you know that's hard, right? Because it's like computing the partition function. It's actually not an observable that you can easily get by forward Monte Carlo sampling. So you can either do something that's called heat capacity integration or coupling constants integration or so on, which means you have to run a lot of Monte Carlo steps and so on. You can, which I don't, won't go into the detail, you can use, I'd really like to draw your attention if you didn't know about this and you're interested in statistical physics, new sampling methods are fantastic. So there are sampling methods like Wang-Landau sampling that aim to, in difference to, let's say, Monte Carlo metropolis algorithms and so on. The task of these sampling methods is to directly produce let's say the density of states as an output of the sampling. Once you have the density of states, you can compute the partition or the entropy in one line. Okay, so these are really great. So there is a PRL paper in 2000 if you want to read it. It's no more complicated to implement than metropolis, but suddenly you can compute partitions and entropies of things that are like 100 neurons in size really, you know, really well and really quickly. And now the third one is really what we were, you know, kind of blown away with because we are kind of stupid enough not to notice in the beginning. So there is a beautiful feature of these MaxEnt models, if you properly construct them, that in that partition function can be simply read out without any computation if two conditions are met. So let me now give you the two conditions. So one condition is that there exists, and this is not by no means guaranteed, but often happens in natural data, that there exists at least one microscopic state whose frequency you can empirically determine very well from the data, right? So in our case, that's the probability that all the neurons are silent. This happens most of the time, they're silent, right? And that's only one microstate. Everyone has to be zero, right? So that you can estimate well from the data by simply counting. And now if you build a MaxEnt model that as one of these constraints is forced to exactly reproduce the frequency of that state, then you're done. Because then you simply take your model, it's right here, you plug in the zero state, let's say I plug the zero state in here, that zero, that all is zero, the only term that remains here is the P of zero, if you want. I have one additive constant to the energy that I can always set even that P of zero to zero, and then the probability of zero is simply 1 over z, 1 over the partition, and the probability of zero is actually something that I can directly estimate from the data. So essentially I just take the log of that observed frequency and I have the partition function, which is by construction correct, actually. So the condition is have one microstate that's well sampled in the data and construct a max-end model that, among other things, constrains the probability of that microstate exactly, and then you're done, which is kind of beautiful. All right, so all these methods you can try, they actually all also agree, it's a good consistency check, and now you can plot the entropy per neuron as a function of the size of my network, right? So I take from my recording, I take groups of 10 neurons, of 20, 30, and so on up to 120, I construct these models. You know, I do this many times, so there is a little error bar that I take many groups of 10, many groups of 20, and so on, and I plot the entropy per neuron. And what you see here is a very nice non-extensivity. So we are still in the regime where the entropy per neuron is not constant, right? And that's because in the retina, these neurons are all strongly interacting, and so as I take larger and larger groups, I still have not come to the, you know, these are potentially directly interacting, right? So I have still not hit the size at which this part of the retina would be, you know, not directly interacting with this part, right? So this, the entropy still slowly goes down, and actually, you know, if you play around a little bit with the extrapolations and so on, it seems that this would reach extensivity roughly between 200 and 300 neurons in size, so a patch of 200 or 300 neurons. And for salamander, that's actually consistent physiologically with what we know. If you look what the probability of pairwise interaction between the neurons, sort of in a physiological sense, right? So how probable two neurons are to have overlapping dendritic arbors or to interact through some horizontal connections, right? It's roughly that size, right? So we expect that if we made larger experiments, so we would see these neurons this far apart, we would slowly reach the extensive bound. And then we have the number, right? So the number of about 0.15 bits per neuron is the upper bound on entropy per neuron in the system that we have. Maybe I skip this slide, actually. So now I would like to, so that's an example of using maximum entropy model to put an interesting bound on things. So the second thing you can do is you can predict something that you haven't actually put in the model. So you can ask the model, how well does it, can it predict some other statistic? And in this case here, what we decided is to ask whether the model reproduces well 3-point correlations between the neurons. So I look at 3 neurons, what's the probability of a particular triplet of them to fire together in the data as explained by the model. Again, the pairwise models that are not that good are in black, and this K pairwise models that have the additional V of K there are in red. And they, I mean, they're not perfect, but they are reproducing the data quite well. And in particular, what's interesting to look at is how well do they do? What's the error in predicting 3-point correlation as a function of the network size? And the interesting thing to note here is that this error actually doesn't go up, right? So if you take larger and larger networks, there is more and more 3-point correlations, right? And you only have n square parameters, so you would expect that somehow models get worse and worse, right? Because you cannot fit them that well, which is not what happens. And it's probably not because, again, of an interesting effect, right? So when you, in our case, right, if I take a smaller network of neurons, then what I'm actually doing is building a model for these guys, but kind of all these hidden nodes are interfering with my system. I don't model them explicitly, right? Now I make a bigger model, there is less and less of a hidden part of the retina that I, you know, that I have not, that's not inducing higher order correlations between the neurons I'm actually looking at. So that's a hypothesis that actually the error is not going up because we are explicitly accounting for more and more of the networks in the neurons. And you can do many other statistics, so I won't go into, so you can ask the model to predict other things, not only three-point correlations and so on. All right, so here is an example where you can use this model to actually disprove a claim that was made before, which is that the neurons at the output are close to independent. Now, of course, the paper I showed you before already on 10 neurons showed that they're not independent because the independent model failed so badly. But now there is actually a very interesting question. So they're not independent, but you can ask an interesting constructive question. So, and that is the following. Suppose I observe the state of this full network, 120 neurons, and I choose one out of these, let's say neuron number one. How well would I be able to predict what this neuron number one is doing just based on what all the others are doing from this model? Like completely forgetting the stimulus and everything. It just, there is redundancy in the code, the neurons are coupled, they're correlated, so I have some predictive power of what this guy does based on what all the others are doing. That's shown here. So this is a chosen, randomly chosen neuron. Its real firing rate as a function of time here. And here I ask how well I can predict it from 9 other neurons, so in a group of 10. Among these 10, there is also this one that I want to predict, and there is 9 others randomly picked. All right? How well could I predict from the 9 others? And you can see that from a probabilistic model like that, I can simply predict this, right? I put the state of 9 others in and ask the prediction for my neuron of interest. And you see that from 9 others, I cannot predict this guy very well. This is how I can do from 19 others, from 39 others in a group of 40 networks and so on. Once I come up to 80 or 120 neurons, just on the basis of what the others are doing, I can actually predict, you know, roughly, you know, correlation coefficient 80% or 90% of what this particular guy is going to do. And that's true if you choose, you know, randomly choose many neurons and so on. So here I simply plot how well I can predict a different neuron based on all the other ones as a function of what's the firing rate of this guy. And maybe the plot to look at it is here. How well can I predict from 20 others, 40 others, 60, and this is the average over all the neurons, right? So when I come to these groups of 120, this is starting to plateau out, and my predictive power is roughly 80%, right? So there is enough redundancy in the code that, you know, you can predict the behavior of one of the guys from the other simply from the state of the others with roughly 80% accuracy. Right? So there is actually an option for error correction here, right? Because if you have a downstream readout, right, if one neuron flips wrongly, you can simply ask what all the others have done, and you can, you know, recover, let's say, a signal or something like this. So this means they are far from independent. There is enough redundancy. You can predict very well the behavior of one from the others. Of course, not completely. If you could have 100% prediction, that would be a weird encoding device, right? Because, like, you know, that is completely redundant, right? It's essentially saying one neuron is totally locked into what the others are doing. So it cannot contribute independently to coding of the stimulus, right? It's simply redundant. All right. So that I have some time for the criticality. Yep.
Is there a way to predict the optimal level of redundancy?
Yes, in toy models of efficient coding, yes. There's actually a part of slides that I had as backup, which I say I won't use. But you can then play, essentially you can play a theoretical game where you start with theoretical models of exactly the same sort. They're now not fitted to data. Now you just, you know, say this is my model of the population and ask, what kind of couplings should I put in here? Of what strength? And, you know, can I optimize them such that the population is best at transmitting information? And what would be the optimal strength of the coupling? And you can do that. And it depends basically on two things, critically, so qualitatively. One is the noise level in each unit separately, right? Because you can think about it, right? If each unit is not noisy, then you should not couple them together because you just waste their bandwidth. But if they're very noisy, you should try to correct it. And the other critical component is the distribution of inputs you're supposed you want to encode. That's actually also quite critical. All right, so let me now stay a little bit longer with the last point, which is, you know, these models generate hypotheses about how the neural coding could work, but these hypotheses cannot be checked internally for consistency like all the other things. So you need dedicated experiments or new experiments to test those. So these are really interesting predictions. So the first prediction is that now I have here my Hamiltonian that I have constructed. Whatever I put in for constraints, there is a Hamiltonian, an energy function. And I can simply map out what's the landscape of this energy function. right? So I put in patterns and I change one spin and I ask, what kind of landscape is this? And what you find is that for these concrete models fitted on the data, the landscape is really broken into metastable states, into so there is a particular configuration of neurons here that is at the minimum of energy, and if you flip any of the spins, you will go to a less likely state. All right? And there is a bunch of such minima. You can use sampling techniques and so on to ask how many of such local minima do I find in my data as the size of my neural network grows up. And essentially, the hundreds of 100 neurons, you will find that there is hundreds of such metastable states in the data. So I cannot find all of them. I can just find the ones where if I take a pattern from the data and ask, is that at the bottom of a well, I can check whether it is or not, right? So in my recording, there is hundreds of such metastable states. Here I give some examples of real patterns from the retina, 120 neurons here. These are samples of patterns that belong to a basin that is centered on the state where everyone is silent, right? So this is an all silent basin with little perturbations on top of it. This is another basin. This is these patterns here in this block illustrate another such basin that's defined by a pattern at the bottom where this guy are on, and then there is fluctuations on top of that, and so on, right? So you can find such basins, right, that are, single spin or several spin fluctuations on top of the state that's at the bottom. And if you look at the similarity matrix, if you sort all the patterns that happen by experiment by putting together all the ones that belong to basin number 2 and 3 and so on, you see, as expected, that patterns within a basin are much more similar to each other than patterns in other basins. And lastly, if you now remember, we have repeats of exactly the same stimulus. When we fit a model, we don't make of use of that at all. We just make a model that reproduces means and covariances. But I have repeats. So now for every pattern that happened in the experiment, I can ask which basin does it belong to? This one. And I can ask now, as time goes by within the repeat, what's the likelihood that the retina is in the blue basin? This line here. What is the likelihood that it's, which is, basin number 2. What's the likelihood it's in basin number 3, which might be this thing, and so on. And this is the probability that it's in a given basin as a function of time, right? And what you see is that the retina really moves quite reproducibly, this is probability across the repetitions, quite reproducibly from one basin to the other in a particular sequence, right? So it's basically, while microscopic patterns can differ a lot, if you look in two repeats at the actual microscopic pattern, it can differ in many, many neurons. But what's much more reproducible is basically saying the retina goes from silent basin into number 3 and then into number 2 and back into the silent one and so on. So this suggests, and again, that's a hypothesis that we cannot evaluate in this data set, so you need new experiments to test it. But this suggests a picture where the information is actually encoded in the identity of the basin rather than in precise spiking pattern. All right? And we know that single neurons are noisy, so precise spiking pattern is not presumably a very good code. It's not stable to noise. We have preliminary data, and we hope to submit a paper soon where we took this idea seriously and simply really said, what a good description of the retina is, that there is a hidden collective state, which is Zika basin here, and then, try to infer what is this basin code, collective state code, basically. And there is some very nice results about this that, I will leave for another talk. But that's one suggestion, that information is encoded in the basins. And note that if we could do it, there is a perfect, there is a very good test of that. If you could compute the information that's carried by the microscopic pattern sigma, so that pattern of zeros and ones, about the stimulus, the question is whether this information is similar to the information that is carried by the identity of the basin about the stimulus. And know that that's a much lower dimensional object than this. This is a 100-bit binary word. That's just an index number. You're in basin 3, 2. So there is a huge reduction that has happened here. So this information has to be larger. The question is it almost equal? Because if it's almost equal, then you didn't lose any information by, instead of the detailed microscopic state, you simply tell, which basin the retina is in, right? Then you didn't throw much away. So that's something that we are trying to get to. All right, so let me now go to the signatures of criticality. So what we are now going to do is we are going to look at the data and ask a very simple question, both of the model and of the raw data. And the question is simply this. Let me take microscopic states that have a certain probability, right? And let me count how many of such states there are. So this is density of function, okay? How many microscopic states have a certain energy or a certain probability, which is the, you know, log probability is the energy, right? And so I can compute this density of states, or if you want, the microcanonical entropy is just the log of the number of microstates which have a certain energy. And now this gives me a curve, you know, the microcanonical entropy. And we want to look for special behavior in that curve. And one of the special behaviors, of course, signatures of criticality, which in this framework can be defined by points where the second derivative of this curve is equal to zero. Right, so one can slowly work this out and see that, you know, for instance, this in your canonical picture would correspond to divergent specific heat, let's say. Right? So I can try to, because many patterns, surprisingly so, many patterns in the data, microscopic patterns, do repeat exactly. I can try to get their empirical estimate of the probability and try to compute at least a part of that curve directly from data, which is what you see here. So here is the energy per neuron, which now from data directly is simply defined as log probability that I see by counts, log probability that some pattern has happened. And here is the log how many times, here is the probability that a certain pattern has happened, and here is the log how many patterns have that probability for networks of different sizes. So this is for a network of 10 neurons and 20 and 30 and so on, up to 100, you know, 60 or so here. Now, I'm definitely limited by sampling. This is by counting from the data. So I see less and less of that curve when I go to larger and larger networks. I only see this little blip here. But what I see when I, so here is basically, if you want, taking a limit towards larger and larger networks, right? And what I can do is I can try to extrapolate what would be the universal curve in the limit n goes to infinity of entropy versus energy. And here are the extrapolations. Sorry, you should see little dashed lines, but I don't think you see them very well. So I can essentially extrapolate this with the system size. And if I extrapolate to very large n, I see that this entropy versus energy extrapolation points fall are these black things with the error bar. And surprisingly, they fall actually on the straight line. All right, so this is the line where entropy and energy are equal, right? Now that's very interesting and peculiar, because it would mean that this equation for the critical point is actually not satisfied only at one point. It's even satisfied across this whole early region, right? So it's a very weird behavior of the system. Now, the nice thing is we can construct exactly the same plot from the models that we fit to the data, from the maximum entropy models, and what you see is here. And of course, now in the model, we are not limited by sampling anymore, so we can extend this curve up to, you know, to sample this density of states however much we like. And this is what you see in the models. So again, in the models, so this goes up to 160 neurons in the data, and the models go only to 120, but you see exactly the same thing. So you see for small groups of neurons, and you take larger and larger groups, these are the red line is 120 neurons, and then you do the extrapolation, and you find exactly the same thing that you essentially are extrapolating to this straight line for a large region of E of S over E curve. Now, of course, if you zoom out and look at the whole energy region, this has to bend, right? I mean, this is a discrete system, so it has a finite number of states in the end, right? So there is only one state where everyone is on, right? So this goes like that. But across this whole range, essentially, entropy and energy are equal to very good approximation. So you see this both in the model and in the data, and it suggests a very peculiar critical behavior where this condition is met for the whole range of E. Now, this has been shown by various people, and including Thierry, and has a paper on this, that construction, so inferring thermodynamics from data going to n large limit, is actually, and finding this linear relationship, is actually identical to finding, if you look at the distribution of actual microstates, to finding a zip flow with the slope of exactly -1, right? So that you can actually also see in the data. So now you can ask whether there's other signatures of criticality in this system. So for instance, you can ask about the heat capacity. Now, of course, this is not an equilibrium system. So the construction I'm going to show you is now a purely mathematical construction, but I can still do it. So I can define a family of distributions now that's parameterized by this t, where essentially I take the model that I fit, which is this Hamiltonian, this energy function, and I can simply put a scale factor in front of it, which looks like temperature, but here you can simply think of it as a mathematical scale factor, right? For every value, and t equal 1 is then the model that's actually inferred from the data. But I can examine, you know, the behavior of this class of distributions by computing the heat capacity as I vary this t. So what you find is here, so this is now, you know, heat capacity under natural stimulation when I vary this t. The red line is where the real neurons are, and this is an average curve for networks of, you know, 20 neurons, 40, 80, and 120. If the neurons were independent, they would have a peak at this green line and it would not move. It's independent neurons, right? So it doesn't move as the size of them. So I can look per neuron. I focus only on the peak. So this is now an intensive quantity. It should be an intensive quantity, C over N. And I see that as I take a larger network of neurons, first I move towards t equal 1. So basically this is, again, this is where the real data lies. And I see a superlinear scaling in heat capacity, right? So the per neuron thing goes up, which is quantified here. So larger the network of neurons, the closer I come to this peak. And there is a quadratic scaling in C, right? So linear in C over N. So you see this emergence of the peak in heat capacity. What's unrealistic about this construction, mathematically that's a construction you can make. Let me finish it. However, what's unrealistic in terms of interpretation is, of course, that this control parameter t right now, I mean, it's a little bit going to also what Frank was saying. When you have a driven system, right, that might be close to critical, identifying control parameters and order parameters is very hard. I mean, and it depends on the system. So here we choose a control parameter, but this control parameter, when you move it away from one, generates ensembles of activity that look nothing like real ensembles in, you know, real neurons, right? So to that end, we have constructed the ensembles in a different way, but maybe I should take the question first, sorry.
Can you, on this plot, collapse the curves using the finite size scaling?
We didn't manage to. Uh-huh. Part of this is because the inverse models are not the same as forward models, right? So here, scaling up the size of the network means something different than it does in, you know, so the usual thing is, right, you do forward models, so you select your J, you might even scale your J's with the system size such that you will get a thermodynamic limit, because that's what you know, what you're after, and then for finite n's, you can do various scalings, right? So here, it's different. So here you have a large system that's there, but you look at subparts of it, which you make bigger and bigger, and the J's come out whatever you cannot enforce thermodynamic limit. You know, it could actually happen that we didn't see any well-defined limit as n goes large, right? There is no guarantee of that. And so then also the traditional scaling arguments don't really apply, at least we could not make them apply. Yes. Yes.
Which is this red, where you will have any kind of currents flowing through different, and then you are projecting its stationary probability on a deep measure type of, and then you find that this deep measure gives you a critical state.
Yes.
But the critical state is somehow something very special at equilibrium.
Yes.
But might be very generic.
Yes. That's an excellent point. So this is what I would like to end up with. So if you can just wait to the discussion. We don't have the answer for this yet, but this is now an intense area of research, right? Which is essentially the question, like in equilibrium, critical points are something that you really tune to, right? There is control parameters that have to be set just right, and then you're critical. The question is what happens in driven systems? I mean, how generic is this and so on? And let me try to do this for you. All right, so I think I have roughly 10 more minutes, 5 to 10, but not more. So I'll try to finish on time. So let me just illustrate the construction very quickly, where you can vary another control parameter, but now you can access ensembles of activity that actually make sense also biologically. All right. So imagine instead of putting a temperature up in front of the whole Hamiltonian, I only put a new parameter, a new control parameter, in front of all the terms that deal with coupling, with collective effects. Okay. So now I tune the knob on this alpha. I can, if I set it to zero, I go to independent neurons because I zero out the correlation term, right? And I can always construct this model such that I enforce this, whatever alpha I choose, I enforce the firing rate of every neuron to be exactly equal as in the data. So the neurons always fire at exactly the rate as they fire in the data, but by changing the alpha, I can simply change the strength of their interactions. So here is how this looks like as an example. So here I have alpha equals zero, the neurons are independent. Here I simply plot for illustration how the patterns sorted in some particular way of these 120 neurons look like. And this is the distribution of correlation coefficients. So neurons are independent, this is zero. This is the data, so alpha equal one means exactly the model in the data. So there is patterns, don't look by the eye that much different. The correlation coefficients have now, you know, are, as we have seen, small but statistically significantly different from zero with this little tail. But if I make correlations much stronger, I can come to this state, which can be quite reminiscent, if you want, of, you know, there is some metastable patterns here, right? I mean, the states are focused across some prototypical patterns, and the correlations now can extend to high values here. So I can have, now I have an ensemble of models parameterized just by the strength of interactions, but the mean firing rates are always exactly matched to the data, all right, in all these constructions. So I can plot the entropy of these ensembles as a function of data, or as a function of alpha. The data is on this line. So, you know, you see what we concluded before. If you go from independent neurons here to correlations in the data, it's slight drop in entropy, but if you make alpha, this correlation strength much longer, there would be a sharp drop, and you would only collapse onto a few stable patterns. And now I can ask, again, I can do an equivalent construction for a heat capacity-like quantity, but now as a function of this alpha parameter, and again, I find that the real system here at alpha equal one is very close to the peak, right? So the strength of correlations between neurons, even when I control for mean firing rates, so they always match the data, the strength of correlations between the neurons is close to this critical state. So if I were to move it, if I were to make correlations a bit weaker or a bit stronger, I would go away from this peak. All right. Now, I would just like to say that there has been a lot of research about criticality networks of neurons before, of course, and mostly, however, they have been focused on the dynamical criticality, which, roughly speaking, means I look at the size of the avalanches, so I look at time traces of the neurons, right, and then basically I ask, you know, how big, so when neurons get active, there is a certain number, n of them, that get active, right, what's the distribution of this n, right? And what people have found, like Beck's and Plans, is that these are power law distributions. People have constructed theoretical models that reproduce this, like this one here. This basically means you can observe, as we do, the zip flow scaling in the distribution of microscopic patterns, exactly with slope minus one, or you can study this dynamical picture of avalanches where you also see power laws, but you see them with different slopes and it depends on the time binning and so on. What is a question, and I present this as a question for research, is how these two pictures are connected, all right? The statistical criticality that we see and the dynamical criticality in terms of avalanche distribution and so on that has been, I mean, do these need to go hand in hand always together, or under which conditions do you find that, you know, one implies the other or vice versa? So this is just a, you know, an open question for research that actually Bill, yes, but also Thierry in particular in a recent preprint, I think I put the, if you're interested, please look at this. This is a very nice paper that's making the first connections between this dynamical criticality and the statistical criticality as described here. All right, so let me try to conclude. I wanted to show that doing a bottom-up data-driven modeling using the maximum entropy framework can be a powerful tool to study, in particular here, the code word vocabulary in neural activity, but you can study dynamics, you can study stimulus dependence, you can also look at other collective phenomena. I think Alexandra is going to talk about antibody, maybe also with Maxent, and you can do, you know, behavior of collective behavior of animals and so on. What I haven't told you, but this is kind of really taking off in neuroscience, is that maximum entropy models, you can use them to learn new things about the code, but actually you can also use them as very sophisticated null controls for doing proper statistical tests, right? By construction, maximum entropy models are full distributional models that contain exactly the components that you decide to constrain, right? So people have been using independent model as a null model for neurons for a long time, but basically maximum entropy models are now a whole hierarchy of potential null models that are ever better, right? So you can say, okay, I have a model that reproduces all pairwise statistics or all third order statistics and so on, and compare that to, you know, to some other prediction, right, as a null model. So specifically applied here, we found some interesting coding properties. We found strongly collective behavior, despite the fact that small pairwise collections are small. There is emergence of metastable state. The entropy does not scale extensively yet at the size at which we looked at. There is lots of redundancy that could be used for error correction. The retinal output is far from decorrelated, as I hope to show, the fact that you can predict the state of one neuron from the other. And in terms of the criticality, we found signatures in the density of states curve and emergent peaks in these very different ensembles. Now, right, so two questions. So the first thing is this system somehow finely tuned to be critical, or there is a dynamical process that puts it back onto being critical, or that's a generic property in non-equilibrium models, as was suggested. So the first two hypotheses can be experimentally tested. The third one is something that requires theoretical work. But experimental test is something that we are actually carrying out. So you can, and have been for a long time because it's a hard experiment. But basically what you can imagine doing is exactly the same thing as you do now, but you do it in a switching type experiment where you show the retina one stimulus statistic for a long time, you construct the vocabulary of its behavior, and then you suddenly switch stimulus statistics by, let's say, going from natural movie to some movie that has very different statistical properties. Either you change spatial correlation, or something like this. And basically what you want to see is you want to construct a model prior to the switch, which hopefully will be confirmed close to critical as now. You want to construct a model long after the switch, where the retina has presumably adapted to the new stimulus, whatever it is that you're displaying. And then just after the transition, where adaptation processes have not yet finished, if the adaptation is dynamic, you would expect, for instance, the retina to drift away in peak of heat capacity from t equal 1, and then the adaptation would return it back. Or if you want the density of states curve being, you know, a line, and after the switch it becomes something else, and then it, you know, adaptation properties return it back to being a line. All right? So this is something that you can experimentally test if you can realize this sort of stimulus. On the theory end, there is open questions. Of three sorts. So the first one is, just from modeling standpoint, how do you choose the constraints well? I mean, MaxEnt does not prescribe this, right? So why did we choose means and covariance? And, you know, there is many ways you can choose constraints, and so there is something about how you do it. The second is, what do we learn about the systems we are trying to model if we compare it using these MaxEnt things, which are as random as possible while constraining exactly the correlation that we have, versus different style models, especially at home in machine learning, that have latent variables, so hidden states, right? Like restricted Boltzmann machines and so on. So there is a family of models formally very similar to this. Essentially, you can write them like this. The only difference is that some of these neurons are now real observables that you observe, and some are putative, invisible hidden nodes that are still, you can still, you know, put in your model, but you know, you don't observe. And those models have very powerful computational properties, right? So essentially, with enough hidden nodes, you can model any probability distribution of any kind, right? So the link between the two and how to use them for modeling is still something that, you know, people are working on, and it's interesting. From the neuroscience side, the question is, what is the role for this criticality, if any, right? And there is many hypotheses. Of course, it can be used to generate long time scales, and so emergent long time scales. There is something we are working on with a colleague that downstream layers receiving this code actually have to learn it, right? I mean, the brain does not get born with the code book that says when the retina receives this pattern, it's a dog, right? So And there are codes which are more easily learnable than other codes. So that's an interesting problem if you want to formalize it mathematically. Of course, critical, much like in what Frank was telling about, is also something corresponding to maximizing the dynamic range. Right? So the peak of heat capacity is nothing else but the log, it's basically variance of your probability distribution. Right? You have at your disposal code words that are either very probable or very improbable, and you maximize that. That basically means to maximize heat capacity. And now coming back to what you asked is the following, right? So what is the nature of phase transitions first in inverse models, so in models of this sort where you do back inference, but in particular also if you have a driven system by some latent hidden variable that you do not observe. So imagine there is a stimulus. I didn't include it in my model. The stimulus is doing this. It's driving all the neurons up and down, very strongly modulating, right? The rate of all the neurons. And then I just look at the activity pattern. I will see this wide range of activity. Will I get critical behavior sort of automatically out, always, slope minus one, Zipf-Low, and so on? So there have been recent papers on this, and I don't think the issue is completely settled, but it's a very interesting question. And finally, what's this link between dynamical and static criticality? All right, so I'd like to end here. Thanks.